Max Nordau, one of my favorite things about Max Nordau is the way he used to trim and comb his beard. This is a look I've never seen before. I think this is the only person in history who has ever parted his beard in the center and, you know, brushed his beautiful, luscious mane to left and right. I was thinking, I suggested to my wife that perhaps I could get away with that if I just grew a few more inches, but my wife was not interested. Nevertheless, he does sport quite a leonine image, and he was certainly no match for Theodor Herzl, very, you know, imposing man with a Grosse Bart with a very thick, dark beard that's very much in fashion today. But nevertheless, he cut a unique presence, and he was really famous for his oratory throughout Europe. Let's look at the most important things. His name was not actually Max Nordau. He changed it from Sundfeld because he felt that Nordau was a little bit more Germanic, a little bit more modern in term. He actually changed his name unofficially when he was a young child in his first published works. And he published at a very precocious young age, first in a school paper, and then before he was 17, he was already publishing in some of the most important German language publications in Hungary. He chose the name Nordau as a pen name, and then eventually he officially changed it. But his actual name was Sundfeld Simon Maximilian, or Simcha Mayer in Hebrew. Sundfeld, his years are 1849 to 1923. His profession was a doctor, like many intellectuals of his age, but he was also one of the most prominent public intellectuals of the late 19th century. Before he was famous as a Zionist, he was absolutely famous throughout the entire European continent as the foremost social critic of his era. His understanding of the ills of fantasy-secular Europe was unparalleled and drew a very wide readership. In fact, many people really came to the first Zionist Congress, not necessarily because of the idea of Zionism, nor because of the figure of Herzl, but because the great Max Nordau would be speaking there. He was a draw. He was like already like a, you know, it's like if Oprah were to come to my lecture, at least double the crowd, right? Because it would be a huge endorsement. And even though Oprah has very little to say necessarily about 19th century Jewish history, but her presence would make that kind of impact. So Nordau himself was one of those people. As I mentioned, he is the co-founder of the World Zionist Congress, and Herzl relied on him extensively, but he is nevertheless forgotten in Herzl's shadow by and large. So we're going to go over the scope of his life and his activity, get a sense of who he was as a human, as a person, and also as a thinker, and specifically as a Zionist. So straight into the material. His youth and family. So he was born in Pest, which is one side of the Danube River. It's half of Budapest. They were eventually united several decades after his birth. And his father was a rabbi and a melamed who taught basically in schools and tutoring as a private teacher, a very humble individual. Later on, after he had passed on, Nordau was going through his father's papers, and he found that his father had actually written quite a few novels and plays and poetry in several languages, and he was quite humbled by the sense that his father led really quite a deep intellectual life without his awareness. Nordau rebelled against his Jewish identity fairly early in life, along with his sister. It was the second marriage of Gabriel Sundfeld, and the two youngest children, Max, or Simcha Mayer, and his sister, were not particularly observant of Jewish law. In fact, even when his sister was about 14 years old, we have letters in which she writes to Nordau saying, you know, I'm writing this in the shed right now because it's almost supper time and it's Shabbos and I don't want father to catch me writing on the Sabbath. So they were part of a generation of Jews who were on that transitional liminal stage where the parents were still adhering to the older traditional lifestyle, but the children were really thinking of that as outdated and outmoded. In many ways, it reminds me of, I think it was Marshall Sklar, the sociologist, who once coined the term the ever-dying people, with reference to the Jews, of course, meaning that, you know, it sounds so familiar to talk about, you know, an older generation keeping the traditions and a younger generation not. And also reminds me of a joke. I'm sorry to tell you this, but I can't help it. It's very therapeutic. Did I tell you this joke? It's a true story, actually. When I was at a funeral once, talking to the Israeli consulate, the Israeli consul.
No.
Oh, it's a good joke, so I'll tell you very quickly. I was once at a funeral. It was a very sad occasion. One of my adult students passed away from that disease, and so we're standing at the, she was an Israeli, and we're standing at the graveside, you know, during the funeral, and the consul general from Miami was there at the funeral, and so he's talking to me, and he sees I'm an observant individual, so he's talking about his youth, and he says, you know, when I was young, I grew up on a Hashomer Hatzair kibbutz. Right? Hashomer Hatzair is like very extreme leftist, anti-religious, communist kind of kibbutzes. On our table on Pesach, on Passover, we had everything. Beer, pasta, bread, you name it. Everything on the table on Passover. Nowadays, the young people, they don't keep the traditions like we used to. Anyway, so just like we're at this time, you know, really the beginning of the 21st century, things have not changed that dramatically in this particular regard at the turn of the 20th century. Here's a little phrase in his memoirs. This is one of the biographies I read to prepare for this lecture. This is a kind of a questionable biography because it was written by Max's widow and daughter. So it tends to present a rather glowing and maybe somewhat hagiographical impression of their husband and father, but nevertheless it has a few really great insights because, of course, they heard everything from the principal himself. And they have his letters. So he writes in his letters, so here's a letter from 1867. He writes to his sister, with whom he was very close, and he talks about how, you know, he used to hate it during the month of Elul, when he was 6 or 7 years old, and his father would rouse him before 5:30 in the morning to go to shul for the slichas. In this part of the world, slichas for Ashkenazim, I think the earliest they get is about 5 a.m., maybe a little earlier, 4:50 a.m. Sephardim have it a lot tougher. Oh, by the way, he was descended from Abravanel of Spanish fame.
Really?
So it's very, even though Sephardic background way, way back, they practiced Ashkenazic rite. Anyway, he used to complain about how hard it was. He was a young boy, and wasn't it terrible to bring him out so early at night? Then he writes, "It was foolish, you may say, to rouse a poor little 6 to 10 year old who needed to sleep. Yet today at 18, I wouldn't mind exchanging souls with the little simcha of 7, meaning referring to himself. I wouldn't mind exchanging my worn out, beaten, dirty soul at all of age 18 with the pure soul of little simcha. I'd be very different. At that time, my incredibly vivid imagination surrounded those slichos mornings with 1,000 mystical solemnities. I simply and truly felt that I was standing before Hashem Tzivakot, who sat very high above us on his throne, desirous of purifying a degraded and wicked world. Today, I believe in nothing, except perhaps in the flavor of a good roast, garnished with fine fried onions and potatoes." Of course, he takes a bath. Of course, I'm doing myself wrong. I still believe in something, in what is more beautiful than and elevated than any religion. I believe in love, in virtue, and the power of true beauty. All I hope is that in the next 10 years, that you won't rob me of this faith, as the past 10 have betrayed my faith in God. Yet nothing moves me like the memories of those days, or like those of the Seder evenings. They too bring me solemn and rich memories, and move me, as Christmas seems to move the believers among the Germans." So he still has, even at 18, and he's clearly left the religion behind quite firmly, he still has some nostalgic feelings for the ancestral faith, and of course, they will return in the form of his very intense Zionist activity about 20 years later. He also was extremely respectful of his parents' faith. After his father passed away, he took his still very firm, very religious mother into his home, and she lived with him until her passing in the year 1900. As a child, as I mentioned, he was interested in medicine early on, and he showed aptitude for it, and eventually went to medical school and became a practicing doctor. But it was journalism that was really his passion, and his remarkably early successes at being published as a youth of 17 was really something quite significant. Also very important in this regard is that he was thoroughly Germanified, which was very typical of Jewish Hungarians of this period. Jews, often as a minority, seek to identify themselves with the state power. This is just something that is part and parcel of Jewish life, again, as a minority, living sometimes in a hostile urban environment. When they have to choose between competing nationalities, and you'll recall that the Danube region was filled with so many different nationalities all up and down its banks, the language question was often first and foremost. And identifying one's language was just one piece of an entire package of national identity that minorities had to determine for themselves. Jews frequently chose the larger power to ally themselves with, linguistically and then furthermore culturally, than the indigenous population. So at least initially, before the turn of the century, Jews tend to be very Germanophile, and then when Hungary started to get much more significant as a nation, then they belatedly joined the Hungarian movement. You can see the same thing happening in places like Ukraine, even in my ancestral homeland, Lithuania. My ancestors were all very, they were actually Maskilim, speaking modern Hebrew and speaking German, but they would never speak Lithuanian. It was only when Lithuania became its own country in 1918 that all of a sudden they started learning Lithuanian and getting some very strange Lithuanian names and things like that. So that's the same kind of thing that happened to Nordau. He was highly identified with the Germanic tradition. When Hungary went through its initial period of Magyarization, meaning the Hungarianness, creating a Hungarian language as a requirement and so on, then he found himself displaced. And his father in particular suffered tremendous economic losses because he could no longer tutor in the German language the way that he used to. One other example of this, by the way, would be Quebec in the 1970s, when the Parti Québécois came to power. Then all of these Jews who had so strongly identified as Anglo, as being oriented towards, you know, English-speaking Canada, which was a minority in Quebec as a whole, although not so much in Montreal, they suddenly found themselves politically displaced. And that's why the bagels in Toronto suddenly got so much better, because of all the Montreal Jews migrating over to the Anglo city of Toronto. Anyways, here's a couple of pictures. He married, he did not marry a Jewish woman. He had two failed love affairs before he eventually married a German Protestant. Ironically, part of the reason for the failure of his second love affair, which was a fairly serious one, she was a... his mother didn't approve, and that scuttled the relationship, and he waited quite a while longer before he eventually married. His third love affair resulted in a marriage and a daughter, Maxa, who is shown here with Nordau. She eventually became an artist of some fame in Paris. This is a picture of his diary, and here he is holding his only child. This is a picture just to give you a sense of where Pest is. This is the Buda side of the river. Here I am with Abraham Cooper from the Simon Wiesenthal Institute, picture with famous people. And then in the background is Pest. Here is this is a picture of where we were standing. It was a really cool picture. My wife took it, kind of like a Disney sort of castle over there. And this is on the Pest side, a nighttime picture. Look, I'm even wearing the same clothes. Actually, I didn't go into Parliament when I was there. Anyways, very beautiful city. Let's go to explore a little bit of his thought. Why was he famous? How did he get this? His most important early work was a critique of European society, shown here's the front page, the conventional lies of our civilization. In the title itself, you get a sense of his personality. He was a gadfly. He was a critic in the common sense of the term. He tended to be take things apart, look for the flaws. He was extremely intolerant of hypocrisy, no matter how minor. And he exposed all kinds of negative things in civilization that he felt had to be changed. Very little Jewish content in his early work, but it was extremely popular. Translated, believe this or not, into 15 languages, including Chinese and Japanese. Just think of how important this must have been in 1893, that they needed to have 15 different languages, including two Asian languages. And since we're talking about translations, I wanted to show you these. This is just purely because I like it. This is this just came out last year. This is the Ukrainian translation of my first book. That's a very cool book, I think. And this just came out last year too. Spanish translation of a different book. And I feel really proud that what I wrote in English is now being read in other countries and other languages. Available now on Amazon. Thank you. Okay. I appreciate the applause. Let's just go back. Let's look at it again.
How do they change your name in Spanish?
My name is still there. Henry. And in Ukrainian, it's Henry Abramson. Same name. Right. Okay. All right. Enough of that. His book was also banned in Austria and Russia, which is one of the reasons that it got so popular, because if you want to make a Jewish book popular, you definitely have to ban it. You know, I'm hoping someone will ban some of my books so they can really take off. But it's not a Jewish book. There's like no significant discussion of Judaism or anti-Semitism, even though this was written by the son of a rabbi with a fairly extensive Jewish knowledge, a very bright person, but he just did not feel it necessary to go into his Jewish background whatsoever. This would, of course, change dramatically in the next few years. And in fact, before we go to one other book, ironically, probably his most well-known book was called Degeneration. It is not really the most emblematic of his thought, neither in his Zionist period, which was the majority of his life, nor in the pre-Zionist period, but for some reason it really struck a nerve and was even republished in the 1960s. It's very rare that you have a book published in 1893 that is then regenerated again in the post-war era. But this book, Degeneration, essentially attacked a whole category of art and culture, which he felt was catering to the most base elements of human thought. His number one target was Oscar Wilde, shown here, for reasons which I think we could probably surmise, but need not delay us here as we look at his more Jewish-related biography. He also coined the term, the title of one of his books, Muscular Judaism. When he eventually got around to Judaism, one of the ways that he formulated his social critique of Judaism was the sense that he felt that Jews had essentially cowardly receded into the background, that they had folded into themselves and they had not taken the first bold step forward to redeem themselves in the modern environment. The book was called Muskel Judentum, it was a tremendous inspiration to Vladimir Jabotinsky, who was a very prominent Zionist that we've spoken about last year, who tended to take a much more aggressive approach to what would eventually become the Israeli-Arab problem. He felt that Jabotinsky felt that Jews could not rely on the goodwill of the nations of the world or of the Arab neighbors of Israel to reach for coexistence. He felt that the Jews had to simply step forward and be muscular. And this concept really he owes to Nordau in particular. This is a counterpoint to his philosophy, which is known as solidaritarianism. I always have difficulty spelling it, and I'm sure after this lecture I'll probably forget it entirely. But solidaritarianism was actually the subject of a dissertation written here in New York. I don't exactly understand what the real major thrust of this philosophy is, but it seems to be a lot, as the name solidarity implies, a basic belief in the ultimate goodness of humanity, the value of cooperation, the value of collaboration, and things like that. But very much a counterpoint to muscular Judaism as a philosophy for Jews. Okay, so any questions to this point, arguments or discussions? Yes, please.
What influenced him? Who influenced him back to Nordau?
Jewishly or in terms of secular thought?
Well, that's probably, obviously, I think his father, but secularly, his leanings, how he thought of Judaism, how he viewed Israel.
I think that's an excellent question. The names that come to mind, the ones that I remember reading in his reaction, were primarily foils, people whose ideas he rebelled against in particular. In this area, I would cite Henry Chamberlain and Comte de Gobineau. These are figures of the mid to late 19th century who began to define this theory of race. And specifically, they argued that the Jews were a vermin race that were bent on dominating the world through infecting healthy body politics. And that's, it's a very noxious kind of doctrine that eventually would become German folkism and ultimately Nazism and various forms of integral nationalism in general. But, you know, Nordau reacted against that very powerfully, and his response to it ultimately was Zionism. So let's zoom in on Zionism now. He's Herzl's right-hand man, as we mentioned. We know that. Herzl was also a native of Pesth. They had Hungarian language in common, but more significantly the German language. And he was 11 years his junior. They're both involved in journalism. And of course, they were both in France at the time of the Dreyfus Affair, which had a huge impact on the two of them. The Dreyfus Affair, I'm sure all of you are familiar with it, but just to give the very broadest outlines, there was a discovery in the French military that someone was selling secrets to the Germans. And of course, the French and the Germans had a long-standing feud. They had a war basically every 30 years, which means that we're just about due for one, God forbid, any minute now. And there was a movement inside the military to pin the blame on Alfred Dreyfus, a Jewish captain who was not especially well-liked by his peers, and Dreyfus was framed for espionage. He was tried three times and found guilty all three times, and eventually sent off to a prison island at Elba, and ultimately, largely because of the efforts of Parisian liberals like Emile Zola, who printed that famous newspaper headline, like a 200-point type, "J'accuse, I accuse." He essentially laid the blame not only on the upper echelons of the military, who were complicit in this frame-up, but of the French judiciary, who had participated in a sham trial, and he essentially said the entire law and order system in Paris was shot. Ultimately, it was clearly obvious that it was not Dreyfus who had actually sold secrets to the Germans, and he was released, but he was not pardoned until 100 years later. It was a huge stain on French society at the time. But what's relevant for our purposes is that, you know, both Nordau and Dreyfus witnessed these French crowds screaming for the murder, for the capital punishment of Dreyfus, calling him a traitor, saying death to the Jews. I mean, not just this particular guy who was a traitor, but all Jews. And it was kind of like a huge reversal of everything that had happened in France since the emancipation, fully 100 years prior. So both Herzl and Nordau were amazed. How could this happen in the country that first gave Jews emancipation? How could it happen that they could turn around and, we could see that it was all just for show? Well, I'm going to read you a little bit in a second from what he said about that at the First Zionist Congress. At any rate, Herzl himself goes to his friend Dr. Emil Schiff, and he says, I have this amazing idea, and I'm serious about it. Why don't we move all the Jews of Europe, or at least those Jews who are suffering and unpersecuted, why don't we move them to the ancient land of Israel in the Middle East? And his friend Emil Schiff listens very carefully and then says to him, now that I've heard you say this idea, I have an excellent person for you to talk to. someone like this, Sigmund Freud, he said, you need to see a psychiatrist because you are definitely experiencing some mental trauma here. And we told him he was essentially crazy. What are you, nuts? So Herzl had no luck with his friend Emil Schiff. So then he went to Nordau and gave him the same story. And Nordau said to him, if you are insane, we are insane together. Count on me. Which was the beginning of an extremely important friendship, relationship, professional relationship that lasted until the end of their lives. And of course, the first major moment was the convening of the World Zionist Congress in 1897, an extremely important event 2 years after the Dreyfus Affair, which represented the first gathering of world thinkers, from Jews from all over Europe in particular, to get together to seriously discuss in Basel, Switzerland, the possibility of creating a Jewish state in Palestine, in the land of Israel. Here, of course, are all the delegates to Israel. You can see right at the center is none other than Herzl himself. And when you zoom in, it gets a little grainy, but you see on his right hand, quite literally, is Max Nordau. He is the number two guy for the entire thing. Yes,
was question. There any religious involvement among the delegates?
That's an excellent question. There were definitely delegates who were religious, but the religion as a whole was kept at arm's length. Mm-hmm. And we'll explore this, God willing, in future lectures. Nordau in particular was associated with the creation of one of the most important documents of the Zionist movement, which was the Basel Program, which is shown here. I believe this is in his own hand. And it's kind of like an amazing thing. You can have all these delegates, all these Jews to get together and create one document like that. It's an amazing achievement. I think I told you the joke about the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Bible. Tell it again, why not? Okay, I'll tell it very quickly. It's actually a joke that I heard in the name of Rabbi Yitzhak Kuttner, very important rabbi of America. The story goes in the Talmud that the king named Talmei got 70 Jewish scholars, and he put them in 70 different rooms, and he gave them a copy of the Hebrew Bible and said, please translate this into Greek. When they all came out later, and they compared their versions, there was a miracle. Each one of the versions was identical. And apparently, Rav Kuttner once said that, you call that a miracle? That's not a miracle. Take 70 scholars, 70 rabbis, put them in one room, see if you come up with one version. That would be a miracle, right? I thought that's funny. Okay, so here it is. The program, and amazingly, it came out. There's only one very significant change we can see written here above the letters. Let's look at the text in English. Zionism seeks to secure for the Jewish people a publicly recognized, legally assured homeland in Palestine. So we should break that down a little bit. First of all, the whole idea of getting together was to agree on what exactly we are going to do and how we are going to do it. Do not be distracted by the term Palestine. This is, it's just used as a geographic locator. The term Palestine was coined by the Romans way back 2,000 years ago because they wanted to replace Judea, which obviously has very Jewish connotations, right, named after Yehuda, with a name after the enemies of the Jews. The most well-known enemies are the Philistines or the Plishtim, and so they chose the name Palestine after the enemies of the Jews. It's just a descriptor. You often find Jews before 1948 referring to the land as Palestine without any political connotation. So anyways, what does it seek to do? For the Jewish people, a publicly recognized, that's the term that's written up here. Öffentlich, rechtlich, gesicherte Heimstätte. Translating more literally, openly, legally secured home state. And all of these four words were the subject of tremendous debate. Some delegates wanted internationally recognized, which would have a very political connotation. Nordau and others said, look, we just want real estate. We just want to be able to put people there. Similarly, they don't use the word shtet alone, state. They use the word Heimstätte, which means like a homeland, which could mean state, could mean a political entity, but it's a little, you know, softer. It could mean simply a protectorate, could mean a province or a, you know, a gubernia, something like that. So it's softened. But they right to the last moment they were debating, and that's why they had to add this word here, openly recognized, meaning it shouldn't be something that happens behind closed doors. It should be, you know, ene kol ha'adam. Everybody should be able to see this. So how are they going to do it? For the attainment of this purpose, the Congress considers the following means serviceable, meaning this is what we're going to do. Number one, the promotion of the settlement of Jewish agriculturalists, artisans, and tradesmen in Palestine. This is the inheritance of the Kibbutz Zion movement that was very active in the 1880s, which actively promoted the agricultural development of the land. It would feed very much into the strong socialist sentiments of many Zionists who wanted Israel not to be another kind of like Western European capitalist nation, but wanted it to be some kind of socialist paradise, a communist paradise even, where Jews were actually getting involved in the land. This is very much in consonance with the 19th century values, with the thought that people derive their identity from their connection specifically to farming. Jews who were overwhelmingly urbanized, overwhelmingly involved in trade and commerce, lacked that connection to the land, and Zionism was viewed in many ways, I'll take your questions in a minute, let me go through a little more, that Zionism was viewed in many ways as an attempt to rectify that. Secondly, the federation of all Jews into local or general groups according to the laws of the various countries. It's an interesting kind of note here, note number two of the Zionist program, which essentially argues for the organization of Jews in other countries, that they should be establishing themselves as organized groups. Kind of like what federation means in America, although sometimes this was envisioned as a much stronger entity involving a national register of Jews who would pay taxes to a central authority, have those taxes then be redistributed to schools and things like that. So item number two really argues to the organization of Jews elsewhere. Zionism was seen not only as a movement in one small part of the world, but they viewed it as something that would energize Jews all over the world. Third, related to that, the strengthening of the Jewish feeling and consciousness. Here you see some of the impact of the thought of Achad Ha'am, who in many places clashed with Nordau, and they were eventually buried right next to each other, arguing that Zionism should inspire Jews to be more Jewish, which is much more consonant with many religious values, and it's going to bring you, you know, towards God and Torah and things like that, without necessarily demanding, you know, that the border is going to be drawn here and the flag is going to look like this. It's very amorphous, but generally dedicated to the benefit of Jewish community. And fourth and finally, preparatory steps for the attainment of these governmental gains, which are necessary to the achievement of the Zionist purpose. This is Herzl down here, whose main Zionist activity was essentially shuttle diplomacy, going from government office to important figure to celebrity, and trying to garner support by schmoozing and lobbying and kind of like a traditional hishtadlut, shtadlonis type of approach, which had served the Jews so well for so long. But this is the main achievement of the first Zionist convention. With your permission, I'd like to read to you a little bit from Nordau's electrifying address of that time. So here he is. This is, I'm just guessing that he probably spoke, based on the length of this English translation, he probably spoke for somewhere in the neighborhood of 20 to 30 minutes. So I'll just read you a couple pieces here. And he has kind of like a diagnosis of the Jewish problem. He's a big thinker, he's a major social critic, and he's saying this is what the problem is. I must utter the painful word. The nations which emancipated the Jews have mistaken their own feelings. Right, remember, he's writing 1897. At this point, every country except Russia has ultimately emancipated its Jews, meaning given Jews equal rights. Russia would not do so until 1917, when the Romanov dynasty fell. But even Germany, even the German lands, have slowly, you know, hesitantly given Jews equal rights. In order to produce its full effect, emancipation should first have been complemented in sentiment before it was declared by law. Meaning, they may have given us equal rights on paper, but they didn't believe it. The broad swath of society did not really want Jews to be equal. It was only maybe those people, liberals in the government who had high-flying ideas, who would like say, okay, Jews are equal now, but really, you walk in the street, it's not the case. But this was not the case, look, that's what he says. I feel so smart. The history of Jewish emancipation is one of the most remarkable pages in the history of European thought. The emancipation of the Jews was not the consequence of the conviction that grave injury had been done to a race, that it had been treated most terribly, and that it was time to atone for the injustice of 1,000 years. It was solely the result of the geometrical mode of thought of French rationalism of the 18th century. This rationalism was constructed by the aid of pure logic, without taking into account living sentiments and the principles of the certainty of mathematical action. And it insisted upon trying to introduce these creations of pure intellect into the world of reality. The emancipation of the Jews was an automatic application of the rationalistic method. The philosophy of Rousseau and the encyclopedias had led to the Declaration of Human Rights. Out of this declaration, the strict logic of the men of the Great Revolution deduced Jewish emancipation. Skipping down a little bit, as the French Revolution gave to the world the metric and the decimal systems, so it also created a kind of normal spiritual systems, with which other countries either willingly or unwillingly accepted as a normal measure for their state of culture. In other words, what he's saying is like just like the French came up with the metric system, which is like really a sensible system, which is probably the reason why the United States of America has not yet fully adopted it. But it's, you know, everything's based on a number 10. You know, you have 10 milliliter or 100 milliliters, you have 10 decameters, 10 centimeters, a meter, 1,000 meters is a kilometer. It all makes sense. Water boils at 100 and freezes at zero. Not like American water, which boils at 212, that's easy to remember, and freezes at 32, right? Very simple logical numbers. So the French, they invented a really great system of measuring things. So too, they invented ideas of logic and government, which other countries felt constrained to accept based on logic, but they didn't believe it in their heart. And so in other words, what he's saying is that the other nations accepted legal emancipation for Jews, but they didn't give them social emancipation. They didn't really want the Jews in their country clubs and, you know, in their athletic games and in their culture and so on. And that's ultimately a very prescient and wise assessment of the state of Jewish culture at the end of the 20th century. He gets even scarier when we look at the 10th address, but let's skip on. So his diagnosis of the Jewish condition, looking a little bit more deeply, he basically says two things about European Jewry which have proved to be historically quite accurate. The first is that the Eastern Jews were impoverished, I mean physically impoverished, like impecunious, broke, starving, without economic possibility and dependent on charity, and they were really broken in many ways spiritually. Certainly this is the heartland of Torah Judaism, and you have some phenomenal great people living in Eastern Europe at this time, but the broad swath of the Jewish population, he felt, was just completely shattered by their horrible living conditions. And in the Western world, in Germany and France and in England, the Jews had a tremendously advantageous economic situation, but spiritually their lives were quite empty. They didn't have the Torah of the East, but they had all of the economic benefits of the West, and they were seeking for meaning in all the wrong places. With those two things together, he felt that Zionism could, on the one hand, meet the needs, the actual pecuniary needs of the Jews of Eastern Europe, and also meet the intellectual, spiritual needs of the Jews of Western Europe. This is kind of interesting. This is, I think, from the 5th Congress. Sorry, it's a little grainy, but it's a beautiful image. It says here in Hebrew, our eyes will once again see your return to Zion in mercy, which is obviously a messianic kind of invocation. And in the background here with the sun setting, you will see a Jewish farmer with a plow. And over here is kind of like an angelic feature, kind of like, what's the name of the artist that does all of these here? I forgot his name, but it was very popular in the 1920s. And he's this angelic figure is consoling this impoverished old Jewish figure with a large yarmulke, and pointing forward to the new dawn happening in Israel. This is kind of the mood of early Zionism that could invoke this beautiful biblical rabbinic legacy and point to a new productive future and an entire, you know, renovation and reinvigoration of the Jewish spirit. Okay. In the 10th Congress in 1911, I'm going to read you one passage from that. Oh my gosh, chilling. This, by the way, this edition of his speeches was published in 1941. And obviously before the mass murders of the Einsatzgruppen and the gun in Germany, and certainly before the gas chambers began to operate. So, but even the editors of this book in 1941 felt constrained to put a little asterisk and write, this was said before the First World War. Wow. Now that we've lived through the Second World War, which was so much more awful, it's ever worse. He says, where is it here? Solemn peace congresses are held at which declarations are delivered against war and long arbitration treaties are concluded by dozens for its prevention, while a great philanthropist has built for them a splendid palace. Vast millions are contributed in every land for the foundation of hero funds for the reward of brave deeds in the service of humanity. In numerous great cities, rich libraries are founded for the spread of culture. Very fine, very beautiful. But the virtuous governments which work with such noble zeal for the spread of eternal peace acquiesce in the downfall of 6 million creatures. Acquiesce, and no one except the victims raises a voice against it. Although this is an incomparably greater crime than any war, for nowhere, no war has ever yet destroyed 6 million lives. A chilling kind of direct reference to, obviously, the demographic losses of the Jews in World War II. Earlier on in that address, he also talks about things like, you know, the Jews need refuge and need to flee somewhere, and yet all the borders of the world are closed to them. This is in 1911. Wow. This is, you know, it's incredibly pressing. Okay, now let's turn to the Uganda crisis, which is the low point of his career and a very important moment in the history of Zionism. So in 1903, the terrible pogrom in Chisinau, which is in Moldova, back in Bessarabia, on the Black Sea, next to Ukraine. A horrible pogrom with hundreds of lives lost. It was the context that inspired the poem City of Slaughter by the poet laureate Nachman Bialik, very important poem in Jewish literary history and also in Zionist history, because he condemned the Jews for cowardice in the face of the pogromists. And it was such a horrible international event that the British colonial secretary, Joseph Chamberlain, said, listen, Zionists, you know, we appreciate what you're trying to do. It really makes sense that there should be some kind of refuge for Jews somehow. At this point, England does not control Israel. It is under the Ottoman Empire. But tell you what do you think of a nice piece of East Africa? Now, he was referring actually to Kenya. For reasons which are not clear to me, this became known as the Uganda proposal, which is a neighboring land. The land he was thinking about was actually in Kenya. But he said to the Zionists, listen, this is part of British territory. We Brits feel an especial fondness for the Jewish people. There is a very strong tradition of Philo-Semitism in England. And, you know, how about it? Herzl, who is a raison d'etre for Zionism, was fundamentally based in the refuge model, meaning that the whole point of Zionism was to give Jews a place to flee to, a place of shelter. So obviously Israel itself has a great poetic value, but would it be better to to have Uganda than to have nothing at all. So he decided to bring it to his second-in-command, and they brought it to the Zionist Congress that year, and they argued that in fact they should take the British up on their offer, not necessarily abandoning eventually the idea, the messianic ideal of returning to Israel, but at least for the sake of providing shelter for those hundreds of thousands of Russian Jews in particular who were endangered by the pogroms, but at least have a place where they could live in safety. Nordau was not enthusiastic about the plan, but he was a faithful deputy. Given that Herzl felt that it was a, it was at least something, so Nordau went along with it and he endorsed it. He called it a Nacht Asyl, which is a German term he coined for meaning night asylum, night rest, right? Some place where for one night, because they're on the run, because they're haggard and tired and bedraggled, let them at least have one night's rest in East Africa, so to speak. And so he himself took it to the Congress and said, let us vote on this proposal of the British. Amazingly, the Congress voted 295 to 178 in favor of taking the British up on this, at least to consider it, at least to engage in it in a exploratory commission of it. Now, even though the Congress actually voted in favor, and it was by a significant margin, the fact that of those 178 delegates who voted against it, the vast majority were from the East themselves, had a huge moral statement. Meaning, if the Russian Jews, who needed this more than anybody, were the ones who were opposing it, then what right did the Western Jews, who had no intention of moving to East Africa, how could they push this down their throats, so to speak? So in the 1905 Congress, even though they did push it forward technically, they decided to abandon the project in 1905 and it went nowhere. One interesting footnote, a young man named Chaim Selig Luban actually pulled out a gun and shot at Nordau. He did not harm him, but he shouted, "Death to Nordau the African," as he did so, because it was just indicative of the sense of betrayal that ordinary Jews felt for the votes of the Zionist Congress in favor of the Uganda proposal. Nordau himself, in an act of great magnanimity, actually testified at Luban's trial in his defense and argued that the young assassin should not be punished because he was simply passionate about a cause that so many of them cared for deeply, and he could identify with the betrayal that he felt. This is, by the way, not especially relevant, but just to show you, instead of Jews going to Africa, or Israel now goes to Africa, and this is just a nice poster showing many of the interesting projects that Israel mounts in Africa specifically. Okay, going on, after Herzl. So Herzl dies suddenly in 1904, leaving the movement bereft of its leader, much like the Jews seeking to enter the Promised Land had to do so without their Moses so long ago. Nordau was Herzl's hand-picked successor, but he refused it. He did not feel that he was worthy to be the leader of this movement, and he preferred rather, because this is really much of what was his standard operating style, was to be a critic from the outside, very productive and significant critic, but to be a constructive leader was a very difficult thing for him. But it was a period of tremendous brutality against the Jews. World War I erupted in 1914, and short on the end of it, you have these horrible pogroms in 1919 that swept across particularly the region of Ukraine. That book that I showed you a while ago in Ukraine is actually dedicated to this period of time, which, by conservative estimates, some 50,000 Jews lost their lives in the bloodshed of civilians. Normally we would look at which by the way dwarfs any other period of violence against Jews since the destruction of the Second Temple. Even the 1648-49 massacres were smaller than the 1919 pogroms. Even though we're so proximate to this date, we've lost sight of it primarily because the Holocaust so vastly overshadowed the violence of the First World War. So during this period, Nordau was driven to distraction, trying to think of, you know, how can he push forward the Zionist goal, especially if he's not in the leadership? And he advocated forcefully wherever he could to specifically just get Jews physically from Eastern Europe into Israel. Whatever it takes, whatever the political configurations have to be, that's what he specifically argued for. His tactics were threefold. He believed that Zionism would be advanced by having this population movement, which would create facts on the ground, to use a late 20th century term, meaning get Jews actually living there. And then thirdly, together with that, political activism, which was Herzl's main strategy as well. He had disagreements with many other Zionists of the period. I mentioned earlier Ahad Ha'am, who wanted Zionism to take on a much more cultural cast than a political one, certainly than a military one. But he also opposed Weizmann's practical Zionism, which we'll go into beyond what I really want to do today. But he ended up inspiring Jabotinsky in particular. Jabotinsky was proposing creating a Jewish legion because he wanted to have a military force that would be ready to defend Israel once the English were able to conquer it from the Ottomans, or once the English left, as it turned out. One of the distinctions with Jabotinsky is that Nordau wanted it to be strictly neutral. He didn't want it to be officially affiliated with any country, even the beloved England. So when we look at his legacy as a whole, the stamp dedicated to him, we can see him as having an incredible impact on Zionist history. Literally, without question, second only to Herzl himself. But he was also very well credentialed as a public intellectual, very prolific author, who had a tremendous impact on European culture, completely separate from his Zionist activity. He is overshadowed by Herzl in the historical memory, but to those who know Zionism, they recognize the phenomenal contributions that Nordau made. Here is his final resting place. He died in 1923 in Paris, his favorite part of the world, and then he was reinterred in Tel Aviv in 1926 between Dizengoff, for whom the great street in Tel Aviv is named, and his nemesis, Ahad Ha'am, on this side. And that's it for our presentation. I hope you enjoyed this discussion of Max Nordau's life and activity. I look forward to speaking to you next week, and we'll talk about Bertha Pappenheim.
Are we going to the main building next week?
Main building next week, as usual. Thank you very much for your attention.